Ong Chen, who many of you know, is professor in the Department of Kinesiology at University of North Carolina at Greensboro. And I've known Ong for many years. His expertise is applying motivational theories to develop innovative physical education programs, and in those physical education programs, there is a goal for the students to learn about themselves and their physiology. So to learn about physical activity, and therefore to be able to make good choices about their lifestyle. And he has been involved in the leadership of several federally funded investigations in which he has looked at populations of children in dozens of schools and thousands of individual young people and adolescents. So he certainly is out there in the real world environment from which to share his thoughts. So without further ado, and with the clock running, I'll turn over to you, Ong.
Good afternoon. It's not on the screen. I guess there's a very important concept in John's talk, which is we need to create a restricted environment in schools so that we can, quote-unquote, make children move a little bit more or eat a little bit healthier in their meals. In my talk, I try to go in a little bit deeper, talk about the curriculum, physical activity opportunities, and the policy at the same time in the school environment. Now, when I say the school environment, I mean literally I define it in the sense where children in that place and live on the campus and bound by the boundaries of the school environment and are physically on campus. So their behavior on campus needs to be accounted for. As for the behavior itself, the physical activity behavior I define in my talk is the tangible bodily movement with the purpose of playing, exercise, and learning physical skills. I want to talk about three things in general here. Number one is the environment and the culture of institutionalized schooling, because that's important. That sets a tone for the entire school environment. The second I want to talk about is the effects of four physical activity opportunities in school right now, and their effects on physical activity behavior in children. And third, I want to share some thoughts and reflection based on my research over the years. Of course, in recent years, I did some cross-country study project, and we have a three-year project in Shanghai. So we're gathering some very interesting data, so I want to share that with you as well. Now, when we talk about a school, and we know that school is an institutionalized environment where children sit in a room and study, right? Academic learning is always the mission of education in those schools. Slate did a very interesting study in education, and he looked at all types of schools with all kinds of socioeconomic status, sizes, demographics, try to see whether or not the mission of education is the centerpiece of school curriculum and policy. And what he found was that it doesn't matter. It is. Of course, the school's mission statements can vary dramatically, but this academic achievement is always there. It's always there. Based on that mission of education, no question about that, the school will build their environment around it, right? The physical environment, when we look at a school, is characterized by those characteristics. And we started off with the traditional design, which is like this. I'm standing here and talk to my students, right? So it's very much teacher-centered environment, which shows on the left side of the picture over there. When the new design came on board, we see more and more student-centered environment designs try to make students more comfortable. We interpret and we translate that into sitting longer in the classroom. So we have more innovative type of design in the classroom so that they can sit longer and study longer in a seated position. Now, the social environment in school is something that we're interested in very much. And if you spend some time in school, you know that it is not a physical factor. Often, it's the social factor that demotivates students to be active. So the social environment is very important. Now, when we look at a school with this mission of education as the centerpiece, we know that the social environment is designed based on initially teacher-student relationship. That's one way. But now, even though we're seeing more and more design social environment with student-student interaction and a student-teacher two-way interaction in mind, and we still have this centerpiece of belief that a school is a place where students will sit and study. If we expect students to study better, they better in a seated position. They better in a seated position. Now we look at all kinds of school rules or the rules from different schools, and this sitting position is center in those rules. You have to be able to remain in your seats when the class is going. Now, this center belief creates a school culture. I call it as a sedentary school culture. Students come to school, as soon as they get off the bus, they start sitting. They start sitting. But there is a very, very good reason for schools to do that. How many of us are parents? I'm a parent. I have two children. I move a lot. Greensboro is my fourth university I ever worked in. Every time I move, the number one thing for me to do is to check schools. That's what I do. I talk to the principal. I walk into the school hallway. I look at classrooms. What I want to see is whether or not the children sit there study or fool around. Okay, that's my standard. I want to see a school where children sit there and study, honestly. That's my bias on that. So with this belief, very central in our own and the public minds, and I guess the school sedentary environment has a very good reason to be there. So because of that, we have all kinds of physical activity policies which are not physical activity friendly in schools. Since 2001, we see 44% of schools have cut physical education. We have, on average, the decreased physical education time has been cut is 40 minutes per week. Physical activity or recess time has been cut on average 50 minutes per week. So physical activity behavior is not reinforced in this dominant culture. So a lot of times we start to blame school policy on that. But when you look deeper in schools, there are four opportunities for children to be physically active. There's no question about that. Number one is school sports. Starting from middle school, we see athletics. Right? And recess. Some of those recess is physical active recess, physically active recess. And also, you heard from John, the classroom physical activity or physical activity breaks is another opportunity. And of course, physical education. I'll go over each one of them and give a summary of the research that I have read. Before I summarize my own research. First, athletics. Athletics basically is the only bright spot right now in the literature that shows it can help a large amount of students to become physically active. National Survey of Children's Health in 2007, they published their report, shows that 50% of children from K to high school participated in at least one sport team in our school. And the CDC and the National Federation of State High School Association published their data, support basically their similar results from the survey as well. What is noticeable is the large increase of girls participating in school sports since 1982 to 2012. Very large increase in girls. Now, effects of those athletic events on physical activity in children in schools, and basically students can accumulate 45 to 110 minutes of physical activity. That's a big chunk of activity needed for them. And the students are less likely to become overweight. And academically, they become more self, they have increased self-esteem and a positive self-confidence. But the challenge we've seen is that sports school reaches only 58% of 55 million children who are in school. We still have 42% of them, 23 million, are not active, not participating. Now, these probably are the children that we need to focus on because they are not voluntarily participating in any school sports. The second opportunity is recess. Now, recess is a policy where there's no mandates, there's no standards, there's nothing to govern that. So it's completely at the principal's discretion. So the research on recess is it's not abundant. So it's difficult to summarize a definitive results from recess. From limited study, we know that three states have strong laws about recess. Most of states and the schools don't. 40% of school reduced the recess time since the publication of No Child Left Behind. And we don't have a surveillance program to monitor recess and its impact. From a limited study, and we know that recess does have a positive impact on children's physical activity. Potentially, children can accumulate 25 minutes physical activity time if they choose to be active during recess time. Stepwise, we have studies show that they can increase 14 to 44% of steps during school hours. But we have challenges as well, because recess is not a mandated physical activity program, and the schools normally don't have equipment and a space dedicated to the active recess time. The challenge for us is that because it's a voluntary participation, girls and the low-skilled students may choose not to participate. And again, these are the population of children. They need attention. They need the physical activity the most. Classroom breaks, you heard from John, and there's a lot of potential over there. So I said John's study here as well to look at this opportunity. Using short break time in classroom instruction to give students opportunity to be active, or design classroom tasks to make that task from sedentary, move that task from sedentary to physically active. We have dozens of intervention programs out there showing positive results. Basically, in 10 minutes, you can help children burn 25 to 40 kcal calories. That's a pretty large amount of calories. Think about the 10 minutes time. Right? And a positive academic behavior, you heard from John's presentation, it's so obviously after activity, and they can increase or improve their attention and time on task behavior. We have data to show that those physical classroom physical activity can really help children to control their BMI a little bit better, improve their test scores, and sometimes show their grade increase as well. Of course, the challenge is because class break is short and activity intensity is low, it's difficult to help all children to achieve recommended 60 minutes physical activity time each day at the moderate intensity level. Now, physical education, that's my favorite topic now. It is an environment where it can reach all children in schools. It's the only content area taught by specialists about physical activity, and teachers' knowledge, and it teaches children knowledge and the value needed for an active life, and the skills they need, the knowledge they need. And it has the potential to provide large amount of physical activity to all children. Now, study in physical education has abounded, as far as we have abundant evidence to show that physical education does have a positive impact on children's physical activity. But because the physical education curriculum is localized, we have large discrepancy in terms of content choices and curriculum offerings, and we see discrepancies in the data as well. In terms of physical activity time, and we have a large range of moderate to vigorous physical activity time in physical education, from 9% to as much as 57%. And a physical activity intensity level vary as well, from 1.66 MET to 4.41 MET. So 1.66 MET is very light physical activity. It was not until you reach 3 or 4 that physical activity can be moderate. So we can see this whole range of impact from all kinds of studies. Caloric expenditure measure showing the same thing. But all these activity amount and activity levels in physical education depend on the content and the time we offer physical education. Now, longer time, I'm saying 90 minutes physical education may not result in more physical activity or calories burned during that time. So from our study, the ideal time is from 45 minutes to 55 minutes physical education. On motivation side, physical education is a content that most children like very much. Our data show that clearly. Fitness knowledge is very important because we know in academics that knowledge can really change students' behavior in learning and action in classroom. So if we have a targeted physical fitness-centered curriculum which offers knowledge option over there, like what we did at the Greensboro, we can see as much as 20% knowledge growth in children. Physical skills are important here. Our latest study showed that that's the only predictor that we can use for after-school behavior. Of course, the challenge is physical education is not a core content. I'll talk about the consequences a little bit later. Now, the third part of my talk, after all of these studies and the reviews, what I got from the results. These results make me think a little bit further about physical activity culture in schools. And we have to accept this fact that a school is designed as a sedentary as it is for a reason, right? But that does not mean we need to give up the effort to create a physically active culture within that sedentary environment. I think that's an approach we need to take so that we can be a friend of the institutionalized schooling instead of being seen as a distraction. Certainly, we do need a physical activity culture in schools. I'll lay out those four areas as the places we need to continue to work on. Number one is we need to know that sustained physical activity behavior is learned through activity. It's like learning brushing your teeth. Once you have a child, and you have to spend time to teach them how to brush their teeth. Physical activity is the same thing. They need to be taught to be physically active. Now, the second point is physical competence is developed through actual participation in physical activity. The third is a student embody physical activity behavior from just do it to do it scientifically correct. That's a very important distinction from what we teach to them just them go out and run and play. That's the physical activity we ought to offer in schools. And then lastly, student embody physical activity behavior through living in a physically active culture in schools. In the past four and a half years, our lab is fortunate to have this cross-country studies going. That's a long-term, three-year study. We start off with 11 schools, middle schools in Shanghai, and we ended up with complete data from 8 schools. So So based on that data, we did a little bit of cross-nation comparison. So when we look at the differences from policy down to the curriculum, and we can see some clear differences between what we do here and what they do over there in China. And for our policy, basically our policy is based on recommendations. And these recommendations, doesn't matter from CDC, American Heart Association, or AFERT, now SHAPE, these recommendations really do not carry administrative power when the principal or the superintendents look at them. The standards for physical activity and physical education are the same thing. Created by professional organizations, it doesn't carry that much administrative power. So the principal can opt out. If they like it, they can adopt it. Physical education content is not a core content in the schools. But over there in China, the policy is based on mandates, government mandates. So everything is laid out in the government, in the law, so everybody has to do it. Talking about a restrictive environment, John, so it's very, very restrictive. Standards are made by the Ministry of Education. Of course, they have the centralized curriculum. They want to get this curriculum to every school, every corner of the classroom, so on and so forth. PE content is a high-stake tested area. It is a core content. If your child needs to move to the higher level of education, for example, from elementary school to middle, not elementary to middle, but middle school to high school to college, you have to meet those standards. You have to be successful in physical education. You get tested. You get tested in a few areas that I'm talking about right now. The first area is skill. Students are tested on skill. You have to be good or proficient in one team sport and one individual sport. So you're tested on this, and it's on your permanent academic record. On this. It's just like your math English test scores. The second focus is fitness development. And you have to participate in physical activity, in physical education, and in other programs I'll mention later. To get yourself fit. If you need certain type of work on one component, you need to work on it because you need to pass at least 4 out of 5 of those fitness tests in order for you to be able to move up. And knowledge, of course, and you get tested on knowledge as well. China is known for giving out tests in schools, right? Still test to that day. What's interesting is in schools, they still have this ritual, many rituals about physical activity. One of those, I remember, Weimo here, and I guess Ping here, and we all grew up over there in China when we were little in elementary school. We have this daily calisthenics time, every day. It started in 1950s. They carried over until now, up to now, 30 minutes each morning. Everyone in school, principal, teachers, staff, students, all come to the center playground, do this, 8, 10 exercises. Everybody needs to do that. Restricted. You have to participate. Since 2011, it is mandated that each school needs to offer 60 minutes after class, but in school physical activity time. So during this time, classroom teachers will organize the activity, get your class out of classroom, go to the field to do physical activity. Physical education teachers is responsible for organizing the space, equipment, so on and so forth, or give advices to children and to classroom teachers. Okay. And a very interesting thing they carried over for years is this mini Olympics idea. Each semester, there is a day or two, they're running mini Olympics. On those days, all classes are canceled. Every child needs to go to the field to participate with at least one event. You need to do that. So they still have this going throughout the years. Plus, look at uniform. And we have schools with uniforms, private schools or whatever, but their uniform is sport jackets. Does that contribute to a physical activity culture in schools? Certainly some people do. Over there, I do think that will contribute to a physical activity culture. We did a study, this gave us a little bit of the methods description over there. We have 860 Chinese students from 24 classes from 8 schools in a sample, and then we have equivalent U.S. students as well. And what we're interested in the study is to look at their motivation and their learning in physical education. So we analyze the data. Of course, we try to avoid this cluster impact, and then we use class means as our unit of analysis. What's interesting here is that in both countries, middle school students are motivated, equally motivated for physical education. What's different here is the basis for their motivation is not the same. So for American students, their motivation is based on their perceived competence. I'm going to be successful in sport and physical education. But for Chinese students, they think physical education is important to me. Think about those tests. I got to pass those tests. School and knowledge. We think we're good at the skills, but now we're giving them a test, the Chinese students beat us. But we do know, our students do know a little bit more about fitness and benefits from physical activity. But that probably does not translate into their action. For school, for in-class activity, we're seeing here the red line is data from China. And the blue line is the data from the U.S. So what we can see is that in general, the Chinese physical education classes offered a little bit more physical activity to the students. And these peak hikes, I think it's physiologically appropriate in the lesson. But in our lessons here in the States, the highest physical activity takes place in the first 5 minutes of each lesson. So that's what they are doing in the first 5 minutes, warm up. So warm up will give them the highest or the most physical activity. After that, our lessons just come down here in terms of MET. So based on that, and I think we just have to be a friend of school mission of education. But we think that sedentary environment, it is our job to find a way to create this physical activity culture. Physical activity culture. Some centralized approach may help, but we understand the education system in this country is different from that in China. But somehow we need to go about this state by state, district by district, county by county. So create a centralized system locally and make it work. Strengthen physical education. Strengthening physical education is the key. It is the cornerstone for all physical activity programs in my mind. Some traditions must be kept. Sometimes we all for change, but sometimes when we change too quickly, we throw the baby out with the bathwater. And we need to acknowledge the importance of maintaining this sedentary school environment, because that's what the public is endorsing, and I think for a good reason at this time. So until a day that the entire public or education field think this will change or need to be changed, we still need to work with them and make physical activity as part of the school culture. Thank you all very much.